A very good evening to all. So today I'm going to make a presentation on Bloom's taxonomy. Of course, Bloom's taxonomy is part of our outcome-based education. Of course, this outcome-based education consists of many parts. One is about defining the course outcomes, and then the next is about assessing the students, and the third is to find out whether we have achieved our attainment or not. So this is the basic structure of OBE. But today I'm focusing on Bloom's taxonomy because we are in the process of preparing our question papers for the end semester examination, and as per instructions received from principal, heads of the departments and control of examination, the question should be a minimum RBT level of 3 and above. Of course, that's the instruction we have received, but at the end of the presentation, we will realize that even otherwise, we are supposed to have and supposed to always be at level 3 and above, right? So this is the overall about outcome education. The first is we need to understand. That is a very important point, because initially when this OBE was introduced into our, especially the NBA system, we found it very difficult to understand what actually it is, how to go about it. So that is the first step, understand what it is. Having understood, then yes, accept it. Yes, it is needed. And having accepted, implement it in the system. And do I sit back and relax saying that, yes, I have implemented? No, it can't stop there. Because after implementing it, you see how effective it is. And then improve upon that. See, one thing is always there is a scope for improvement. There is no system, no process where it has reached an ultimatum where there is no scope beyond that. And of course, for those who are familiar with ISO, this is analogous to the PDCA cycle, plan, do, check, act. Of course, what is missing here in this diagram is the aroma, because it goes again and again. So that is the OBE process. So these are the few terminologies that are being used in OBE and also part of NBA, of course. OBE came into as part of NBA system. The vision and mission of the institution, vision and mission of the departments, and checking whether they are in line, the departments or the programs, vision and mission, are they in line with institution's vision and mission. Program educational objective, shortly called as PEO. Program outcomes, PEOs, and program specific outcomes. And course outcomes. So these are the terminologies around which the whole OBE process revolves around. So what are the various steps in outcome-based education? So we know what are the things that we need to define. So we need to define the outcomes, POs, PVOs, PSOs, and CO, that is course outcomes. Of course, for those who are new, program outcomes are generic in nature. That's common to all the programs, and whereas PSO or program specific outcome is the outcomes which individual programs or departments, whatever you call it, what they define. Of course, again, you cannot say department because it's program specific. It's for BE, mechanical, UG or PG. In PG, what program it is. So it is program specific outcomes. So having defined our outcomes, the next step is to set targets. Of course, you know, we are familiar with achievements, especially our institution SVC has been following ISO system for a very long time, and for each of the objectives, it's not sufficient merely to define objective qualitatively and say that yes, I am doing good, it is good, I will improve, I will make it better. These are all qualitative statements, and with that you cannot assess yourself to see whether you have achieved it or not, whether you are growing or not. So we need to set targets. When I say target, is not qualitative targets, it should be quantitative targets in terms of numbers. Only then you will be able to check whether you have reached your target or not. So having set the target, the third step is to evaluate for attainment. So having set the target, enthusiastically, or rather over enthusiastically, I set very high targets and say, I have set very high targets. But unless you evaluate yourself or evaluate the process to check whether you attained or not, then the purpose will not be solved. So these are the three basic steps of OBE: define, set, and evaluate. So I was talking about program outcomes, what a graduate should possess. So in fact, this the program outcomes are the derivation of graduate outcomes, which NBA defines in its website, or in their process rather. So initially it was like NBA defined the graduate attributes, 12 graduate attributes. Of course, the name says what are the attributes or qualities or capabilities a graduate, an engineering graduate, is supposed to possess after completing his 4 years of program. So based on those graduate attributes, individual institutions, they defined their own program outcomes in line with the graduate outcomes. But there were a lot of confusions, and later on NBA from this graduate attributes derived program outcomes. Of course, if you take the numbers, the graduate attributes is also 12, and program outcomes are also 12. They directly match each other. If you're going to map, they directly map with each other. So I just want to quickly list out what are the graduate attributes, because it's important. Based on that only we are going to understand how we are going to apply Bloom's taxonomy into these graduate attributes. So apply knowledge, of course, I want you to remember these terms here, and especially the first one, apply knowledge, because elsewhere I will quote this. Apply knowledge, then solve problems, and the design and development of solutions. Conduct investigation means you analyze a problem, investigate a problem, and to investigate it effectively. Effectively, when I say, excuse me again, someone has switched on your mic. Please ensure that throughout the presentation your mics on, your mics have switched off, please. And to conduct investigations effectively, in the sense in terms of accuracy, optimization, and in terms of time, we need to use modern tools. And engineer and a society, engineer is not an individual, he is part of the society. And environment and sustainability, whenever, especially engineers, you try to come out with solutions, inventions, whatever it is, that should not affect the environment. And growth, whatever you are claiming, should be a sustainable growth. Otherwise, yes, that growth is detrimental to the society and the world or the earth as a whole. And when you're doing anything, professional ethics, yes, it has to be there, without which, again, you know, whatever you do, it's only detrimental to the society. Next is about individual and teamwork. Of course, sometimes you'll have to work as individual, and most of the time you have to work as a team. And when you are working in a team, communication is very important. And if you cannot communicate effectively, then definitely you cannot be in a team. And without being in a team today, an engineer cannot survive in his career. And next is about how do you manage the project in terms of time and schedules, and in terms of how do you manage the finance. And finally, it doesn't stop, learning doesn't stop at any point, it keeps on going. So that's why it's lifelong learning. So these are the 12 graduate attributes based on which program attributes are arrived at. So what to assess, right? So as I told earlier, program educational objectives, program outcomes and program specific outcomes, and course outcomes, these are the parameters that have to be assessed. And as I told you, when you want to assess them, we need to have set targets for them. But after that, we assess to find out whether we reach them or not. So these are these three numbers, the parameters that we need to assess. The next question is, when do I assess them? Having defined them, having set targets for them, when do I assess them? Do I assess them parallelly or in different timings? So that's very important thing when it comes to assessment. This goes higher. First is your assess. Of course, when I say end of every course, doesn't mean you are only your end semester examination. It includes your continuous assessment also. So your continuous assessment, the performance of the students in the continuous assessment, and the performance in their end semester examination, put together, we assess them, right, to find out whether we have attained or not. And next is program outcome, which we do upon completion of their graduation, right? After they graduate, maybe the final semester exams are over, results are out. At that point, we assess the program outcomes. Next is your program educational objectives. This is mainly after they take up a profession. After 3 to 4 years, right? How successful are they? And for their success, how effective was the program outcomes and in turn course outcome? Whether these attributes or these parameters have helped them in establishing, because in the initial 3-4 years are very crucial for a graduate engineer to establish himself. So has these parameters helped them to establish themselves as engineers? So that's the reason why we assess the PEOs after 4 to 5 years. Well, there is no strict number exactly 3 or 4 or 5, roughly 3 to 4 years. Or generally what happens, normally when they join as trainee, then the next year becomes a probation, then they confirm. So it takes minimum 2 years for them to become engineers and get into a task, and from there at least 1 or 2 years to see how successful they are, right? So what to access, when to access. And the next question is how to assess, right? Of course, you know, the simple, if I ask you this question, a simple answer will be, we have continuous assessment test, what we call CAT, and we have end semester examinations, questions are asked, they answer, we evaluate, we give the marks, and based on the marks, we say, yes, he is very good, good, not good, all those things. But that's what we have been doing for so many years. Maybe as engineering history goes, at least a century, we have been doing that. Somewhere we felt that that method or the marks what we give in terms of percentage didn't actually correlate with the quality of the candidate or the quality of the engineer. Someone who has got very high marks but is not able to be successful, survive and be successful in his career. Why? So it means there is some problem in the system what we have. So that method of merely asking questions and giving the marks is not the correct way of assessing the student's quality. So I'm emphasizing the word quality here. Right? So how to do that? So that is where this Bloom's taxonomy, this is the term which is very frequently used, and it is not only used in colleges, even in schools, this Bloom's taxonomy has been used very widely. Right? Of course, many of your kids who are studying in schools, you can take the textbooks and before start of every chapter, they would have given this. Right? So, of course, when I ask the question, who? Yes, I guess Bloom is a person. Who is he? And what did he say? And how do we use whatever he said? So this is what we are going to see today. And Benjamin Bloom is his name. And maybe if you look at the year, we'll be surprised. Rather, first time when I looked at it, I was shocked. Because something that was conceived in the year 1950s, we started talking about only in the year 2013 or 14. Because all these things came to picture, of course, NBA, signed an accord, Washington Accord. Only after that in India, we started talking about outcome-based education and this Bloom's taxonomy came into picture. So in 1950s, Benjamin Bloom, so he just gave a thought to this teaching learning process, and he found that there is more than one type of learning. Of course, if you ask us, how do we learn? Very simple. There is a textbook, probably there is a supplementary material, question answers are given, and we go through the questions, we memorize them, and we have a bunch of past question papers, and there is every probability that 75% of the questions from the past question paper, not even 75, that's only, in fact, it's a pessimistic number, optimistically, when I say optimistic from the student's point of view, at least 90% of the questions are repeated. And a student memorizes that, yes, very comfortably he passes. That is what we call colloquially mugging up or rote learning, right? So, but he felt that that is not the only way of learning. There are multiple ways or more than one type of learning. Why more than one type of learning is needed? So when you talk about skills, there are different types of skills. So he felt different skills are required at different levels of learning. So just one or whatever we have been following, the stereotype of, you know, the teacher keeps, he has a content, he delivers and he leaves, right? That is one type of, that's only one type of teaching learning process, but practically, especially as engineers, different skills are needed, and for different skills, there are different learning levels are required. So with that, he thought, you know, the conventional or the traditional method will not work out, right? We will not be able to impart different skills, right? One thing to different skills. And there are different type of learners also. So with all these things, he came out with this concept of taxonomy. Of course, when you say taxonomy, it is like putting things in order, right? So the basic concept of Bloom's taxonomy is, Bloom's taxonomy is a system. As I told you, taxonomy is, you know, where you classify or group things based on the nature. So we have various aspects like the objectives, processes, principles, facts, of course, where we come now, assignments and questions, right? So all these things have to be put it in an order or in an hierarchy. And when we say hierarchy, how do I set the hierarchy, right? When I say top to bottom or bottom to top, whatever it is, how do I set the hierarchy? So he gave the clue that the hierarchy should be from simple to complex, right? You cannot, you know, straight away jump into probably, I don't know, the lighter side. Some professor might, you know, try to show off themselves and then straight away jump into, you know, high fundas. Obviously, the student, they don't understand, and they don't get understand. They get averse towards you, and they get averse toward the subject itself, right? So whatever, you know, you think that you are a brainy and the high funda stuff you are delivering, it goes waste. So start with simple concepts which they can understand, and build upon those simple concepts and take them to complex systems or complex principles, right? On the other side, concrete to abstract. So when we say concrete, you must give them concrete evidence, which, of course, one thing which I want to emphasize here, especially for the young teachers, the concrete means you teach them with facts. When you say facts, they must be able to grasp that idea, right? Maybe, you know, most of you might have come across this joke, probably I would say a serious joke, a teacher telling, you know, giving example of for the fisherman, right? He says, Bundi turning into a laddu is fission, and the laddu turning into a bundi is fission. I'm sorry, other way around. Fusion is bundi turning into laddu, and fission is laddu turning into fission. So many of us tell this as a joke, but the underlying fact, every one of us whoever came across this joke, we never forgot this joke, because he has told an example which we can see in day-to-day life. That immediately is able to correlate the concept with this example, which goes and sits in his mind strongly. He understands it clearly. So start with concrete things where we can give simple examples where he understands the concept. Then, yes, go to the higher levels where I have told you the high fund aster. You try to imagine something abstract, and how do I derive something out of an abstract concept? Of course, just because it's abstract doesn't mean it's all, it's not solvable, right? It takes time. So this is what he said, the hierarchy should be from simple to complex and from concrete to abstract. So again, you know, probably There are some, as I told you in the beginning, you know, once you say OBE, understanding is very difficult. So when it evolved, when the Bloom's taxonomy concept evolved in 1990s, one Mr. Lauren Anderson, in fact, he was one of Bloom's students. So they formed a small team, and they wanted to revise Bloom's chart. And they published the revised Bloom's taxonomy in 2001. So now from this, you'll be able to understand something which started in 1950s was, of course, if I'm right, in 1956 or 9, actually they started following Bloom's taxonomy, right? So but 1990, Anderson took this up, and he himself has taken more than a decade to revise it. Means the older system was so deeply rooted, it was very difficult to, you know, arrive at a proper system so that people can accept it and implement it, right? So this is the background. Let's not go into what's the difference between Bloom's taxonomy and RBT. And currently, the entire world, we are using only revised Bloom's taxonomy, shortly called as RPT. So we'll get into that. So this is a typical revised Bloom's taxonomy. So it starts from here, remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Of course, they put it other way also, remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and then create. So the base is remembering. Probably all of us know that our system, at least you know, we want to call it as our earlier system, was mostly revolving around this remembering, maybe to some extent understanding, and not beyond that. So now with Bloom's taxonomy, we want to take it to the next level. And one more thing, if you observe, the size of this remembering is the highest among the other elements here, means in terms of numbers, majority of the students, they are comfortable at this level, remembering level. And as you go up, of course, obviously as a pyramid, it has to reduce its size. And when it comes to creating, the number the number of students who go to that level is small. That's what reflects here. Maybe the autonomy is different, but it matches here. When I say a lot of them are here, so it's lots, lower order thinking skills, and as you go up, it's higher order thinking skills, lots and lots. Of course, this is very hot here. That's what we are discussing today. And now, does that mean this is at a very lower level? We should not look at this. So I remember now, of course, I remember again, strongly remember day one in my engineering college, the principal addressed us. He said this, knowledge is but to remember, right? So that is also needed. That is, in fact, the base or the foundation. So applying Bloom's taxonomy, what we do is we move from LOT to HOT, right? So that is our objective. I know I was telling most of them are here, as we go up the pyramid, the number goes down. But if we meticulously follow Bloom's taxonomy, probably the pyramid could be upside down, or these terms could be reversed, right? So I'll come to this later. So now, why this Bloom's taxonomy we are talking much when we come to NBA. So NBA, we were talking about program objectives. That's what I told when we listed out the program outcomes. This was the first one. It was listed there, apply knowledge. And you come back here in the Bloom's level, it is apply. But before that, we have remember and understand, right? What does this mean? Does it mean that, as I told you, these two things are not needed? Right? So if you look at this observation, what happens when a program outcome is addressed, the Bloom's taxonomy level is also addressed along with that, because you know we cannot address them separately. And remember and understand that Bloom's taxonomy levels are not addressed directly by the POs, right? So, and one more thing is NBA does not emphasize the development of these two attributes. And if you are going to have that in your system, and obviously when you have remember and understand, you will set targets for that, right? And you will also calculate the attainment. Probably for those two levels, without much effort, without much difficulty, you can very much set high targets and you can even achieve them. But that's not going to help you in two aspects. One, if at all you are only concerned about getting NBA accreditation, there also it will not help you. And the other side is, if you are concerned about your students' quality of education, quality of knowledge they have acquired, there also you will fail. So it does not apply here. So having said, then do I ignore these two levels and straight away jump into the third level, apply level, and start from there, right? So for that, we need to understand the process of learning, right? How this learning process is set up or defined. So before you can understand the concept, you must remember it. That's why I told you, you know, probably very lately I realized what my principal said. Knowledge is but to remember, right? Next is to apply a concept, you must first understand it. Definitely without understanding, you cannot apply that. And in order to evaluate a process, right? So I am applying a concept and I want to evaluate it, maybe for its pros and cons. To evaluate that, I must have analyzed that system or the problem. Right, so without analyzing, I cannot evaluate a process. And when I want to create an accurate conclusion or you know, accurate evaluation, right, or accurate decision, right, one must have completed a thorough evaluation. So this is how it goes. As I told you, without this, we cannot do. Without remembering, and in fact, probably. Many people they criticize our system where it is only memorizing. But one thing you must understand, you know, many of the Indians are all successful in India when they go abroad also. Why? Because we are strong in that, right? We are strong in that, but probably, as I told you, we are strong here, probably to some extent here. Beyond that, we didn't grow. And when Indians, and those Indians, of course, not everyone, those Indians who are strong here and somewhat strong here, when they go abroad and when they adapt to their system, definitely they are excelling. And definitely I would say, I don't know whether you accept it or not, this is our strength. So now we need to remember to understand, and only when you understand, you can apply. And only when you apply, then you can analyze. Only when you can analyze a problem or a concept, then you'll be able to evaluate the process for its pros and cons. Only when you can evaluate a given process for its pros and cons, then you'll be able to select the right solution. And ultimately, you'll be able to create a new solution or an invention or an innovation. Right? So this is the process of learning. So now I'll give you a small example, because we need to understand these terms. So without understanding these terms, it's very difficult for us to understand Bloom's taxonomy. So pardon me, sometimes it goes this way and sometimes it goes this way. Due to lack of time, I can put it in uniform order. So remembering, so how many ways can you travel from one place to another? List and draw all the ways you know. It's like, you know, of course, it revolves around going from, say, let's assume, you know, from going from school to your home. There may be different ways you can travel from one place to another. So you have to remember that. How many ways can you travel from one place to other? Yes, I can walk, I can take an auto, I can take a bus, right? So I need to remember what are the various options available for me. Next is, how do you get from school to home? So now, having understood what are the ways, I need to select one from that. How do I go? Do I, you know, opt for a school bus? Do I opt for a regular auto? Whatever it is. And now, having understood my requirement, suppose you take a school, there are a lot of people who need to take some mode of transport. So next is applying. Explain why some vehicles are large and others small. Say for example, some schools, they have buses, the regular ones, which they ply only in the main roads. And there may be a lot of students who are in the narrow lanes, right? Where these regular buses, which are large, cannot go inside. So there are small buses. So I need to understand why some are large, some are small. Of course, the other way also, you know, some vehicles are large because they want to carry more load. Some vehicles are small. We have, ECMOVERS. We have normal lorries. We have mini lorries and things like that. Next is analyzing. Analyze means what? Analyze a problem. See, what are the problems with the modern forms of transport and their uses? And you need to analyze them and write a report. Say, for example, there are diesel vehicles where they emit more pollution. Right? There are high speeding vehicles which create traffic problems, which create accidents. Right? So there are different forms of transports and what are the uses. So you need to analyze them. And what changes would you recommend to road rules to prevent traffic accidents? So right, what do? You analyze your problems and evaluate them. And as I told you, when there are problems, there are solutions. And for those solutions, you evaluate each of the solutions for the pros and cons and give recommendations. Say, for example, there are accidents. Then you may say, how to reduce accidents? I put a lot of signs. I put a lot of speed limits and then put signs over there. I put speed breakers over there. Right, so these are all rules, and probably I said, as I told you, speed rules could be 30 kilometers per hour, 40 kilometers per hour. So there are so many options. Among that, what do I recommend? So that is evaluating different options available. And finally, creating, invent a vehicle. Of course, two things can happen. I can invent totally a new vehicle, or when I say create a new solution. At one point of time, government introduced speed controllers or speed governors in the buses. So the driver cannot go beyond a certain speed. So that is creating a new solution for the problem. Because here we have traffic accidents for which I create a solution. And the next level of solution is when some vehicle is at some distance, say for example 10 meters, before your vehicle automatically applies a brake. So that is creating a solution, an innovative solution. Right? So this is an example of understanding how this Bloom's taxonomy works at different levels. Right? Now we'll come to the various keywords of Bloom's taxonomy. So remembering, so the learner can recall from whatever he memorized. And he can restate it, and he remembers many facts. And these are the various keywords. Recognize, probably, see, these terminals are common. Some will be applicable for schools, some will be applicable for colleges. So recognize, you show a picture and say, can you recognize? So from the memory, you recognize it. And you choose between something. And define. This is one keyword probably very frequently used. And again, identify, given a few set of diagrams or circuits, whatever it is, can you identify a particular one? And this is another very commonly used word in our question papers. List the advantages and disadvantages. List various types of computers or machines or whatever it is, right? Name something, right? State something, again, you know, state Newton's law, state thermodynamics law, right? Label, right? Sketch something and the label the parts. These are all, you know, recollecting and reproducing. So for this, how will the questions read, right? Which is the biggest city in India? So it definitely, you know, you don't need an understanding. Somewhere you studied in geography, from that you have to reproduce it. So which is the biggest city in India? Where is Himalayas located? Can you list three something, whatever it is? What is defined? So these are all possible ways or your question statements will look like. So next is understanding, right? So the learner, this is the key word here, they grasp the meaning of information by interpreting what has been learned, right? Probably, I'll give another example. Most of you, of course, all of us supposed to know, Thirukkural. Yeah, there are many students, even kids, you ask them to recite Thirukkural, they will, you know, gragada say, you know, some will say 10, 20, 30. There are even kids who say 1,330 Thirukkurals without making a mistake, right? They'll be able to say, right? Of course, I prepared one and I'm saying this. There is one Thirukkural related to friendship, right? Udukkailandavan kaipole ang idukkan kalaivadam natpo. So ask someone, you know, they'll recite it, they'll tell it without any mistake. Then you ask them, what do you mean by that? They say, no, that I don't know. Meaning until I don't know, this is Thirukkural I know. Right? So that's what the difference between, you know, remembering and understanding. Now when you ask him what is the meaning of the, then he will say, no, yeah, like, you know, and I'm only translating it in English. When someone's, you know, dress tries to go down, hand immediately, involuntarily, goes and then holds that. So similarly, whenever there is a friend, when the two friends and a friend is in need, the other friend is supposed to help him, right? Without hesitation, instantly he is supposed to. So that is understanding of that Thirukkural. So similarly here, of course, grasp the meaning of the information. When I say information, it is a fact. By interpreting it, that is what is understanding. Of course, certain things which we say explain, of course, explain, if I'm right, we are using in both the context, both the context. Explain something which they can write it from the book, but it's not like that. I'll come to that later. How explain comes under understanding, whereas we have been using it under remembering, right? So illustrate something. What do you infer something? How do you relate this to something, right? How do you summarize? So probably, you know, you teach them something and then you ask them to summarize or condense it and then do it. So these are all keywords which will be there when you're preparing questions for at this level, that is understanding level, or in other words, level 2. So these are certain sample questions. State in your own words. That's what I said. You would have told a definition, right? Definition, when you say define, we expect them to write as it is in the book without even altering one letter, as someone would recite a Thirukkural. But when I say explain, he has to explain in his own words, and to do that, he should have understood that, right? And then, having understood a fact, give an example for that, as I told you. A relevant example, right? How would you compare? How would you contrast? So condense this paragraph. I don't know how many of you have done that. Many should have done. When you want to, you know, improve the writing skills of the students, what we do, we give them a journal paper and ask them to condense it and convert it into an abstract, right? Probably not exceeding 300 words or one page, whatever it is. Condensing their paragraph. So only when they understand that, then they'll be able to condense this. I mean, this again is almost similar. How do you summarize, right? And the third is applying the concepts. So the learner makes use of the acquired knowledge, facts, techniques, and rules. So this is the keyword here. Applying it into a new situation, right? So only then, you know, you'll be able to analyze more. Only when you can apply it in a new situation, right? So I was telling you about the Thirukkural. Right, I know the Thirukkural as such. I know the meaning of it, and in appropriate situation, I quote that, and I apply that and say that, see, you have ditched me, and you don't belong, you don't fit into the definition of a friendship what Thiruvalluvar has told. Right, so something like that. You apply the knowledge in a new situation so that you can analyze and then come out with a solution. So these are the keywords, apply. Solve a problem. Probably here many of our problem-oriented subjects where you have taught them the concept, you have taught them the steps involved, that is the formula and other things, and you give them a problem and they apply those things and then they solve it. For this we have been commonly using it. Construct and do an experiment, right? That's what we do, right? You know, in especially part of autonomous. We try to have more of theory and lab combined curriculum and syllabus so that whatever they learn there, they go there. And instead of you know doing a routine experiment, will they be able to create new experiments, right? So compute something, it's almost like solving something, right? Modify something, this is what I said. You know, you're applying it for a new situation. Can I modify that and use it in a new situation? So these are the keywords. And for this, how will my problem statements or question statements will be? So how do you apply the knowledge of latitude and longitude to locate Chennai? Probably the teacher taught him what is latitude, what is longitude, and using that, of course, many of the applications, even probably in your mobile, when you take a photograph, right, when you add the metadata, right, that will have the latitude and longitude, the number will be there. So with that number or the angle, will you be able to locate a particular location, right? There you're applying it. So how would you solve something using something? So would you prefer another plan to do it? So how would you apply what you learn to develop a solution, right? Or how would you organize something to show something? So this is how your questions will be, and the keywords will be, how will you solve, how will you apply, right? What will be your plan, right? How will you organize? So these will be certain statements. So next is analyzing, where the learner breaks the learned information into parts and how these parts relate to one another to an overall structure. Of course, we take a whole system. There are made of subsystems. So first I must understand how the subsystems work and how these subsystems are related to one another and how finally all these subsystems contribute to the main system. So this is what is analyzing. Only when I am able to analyze all these subsystems, then when there is a problem, I will be able to come out with a solution for that. Right? So the keywords are analyze, compare. See, sometimes earlier also I used the word compare. Sometimes, so these are all overall guidelines. Sometimes these terms or the keywords will be in two levels. But as I told you, the actual meaning of that goes with the context of the question. The content of the question decides. Say I use compare here and analyze. I use it also in applying, right? So the context of the question will decide whether it belongs to apply or analyze. So then when I analyze, I discover and I differentiate. That's what I told. When I am analyzing, I'll be able to differentiate between two things. And how do I attribute it, right? So of course, it's a straightforward keyword, examine or analyze. And again, you know, distinguish and differentiate, almost closely related. Right? So these are the keywords. So when I have this, how will my problem statements or questions read? So which statement is more relevant? Right? There are three, four statements. I analyze that. Of course, you can see these sort of things in competitive exams. They give two, three statements, and you have to find out which is more relevant. And what is the conclusion? And make a distinction between. So you'll be able to distinct distinguish between two only when you are able to analyze them, right? So these are few common sample questions under this, right? So what does the author believe or assume? Because when you analyze, yes, you believe, right? And next is evaluating, right? Here, evaluating, as I told in the beginning, when there is a problem, of course, we'll come to this definition. The learner makes decisions based on, so in-depth reflection, criticism of the systems and assessment, right? Through checking and critiquing. When you do this, obviously you gain an in-depth knowledge and you analyze the problem. And for every problem, it's not that for every problem there is only one single solution. To the best of my knowledge, every problem has at least more than one solution, in many cases multiple solutions. Then when I have that, see, I have analyzed a problem, found out there are solutions, and now what I'm doing is I evaluate each and every solution for the pros and cons, and from that I'll be able to decide. So judging, how do I make judgment? Like this applies even in day-to-day life. How do you judge someone, right? Only when you have analyzed his attitude, right, his behavior, everything, then you'll be able to judge a person. And to judge a person rightly, you should have analyzed him thoroughly. Like you should not come to a conclusion based on just one or two instances, right? So judgment, of course, is a straight keyword, evaluate. Appraise something. How will you appraise something? Only when you have analyzed it, then you'll be able to appraise something. Of course, this is one thing which as teachers we regularly use. Every now and then, Dean Research sends a mail, so-and-so is defending that thesis, right? So I go and say that I have done a research, this is my findings, right? And someone says, puts a question, and how do I defend my statement? Right? That is purely by analyzing and evaluating, I defend my. And criticizing, you cannot just like that criticize someone or some process. You should have analyzed, evaluated, and then only you can criticize them, right? And justify, of course, something like this. How do you justify your statement? How do you conclude or arrive at a conclusion and disprove, right? You give a statement or someone gives a statement, you say, no, you are wrong. And that fellow says, if you say wrong, you disprove my statement. And to do that, I should have analyzed completely and evaluated it. And now for this, what sort of question statements will come? So what are the consistencies or inconsistencies that appear? This you arrive at only after evaluating. So which is more important? As I told you, there are multiple solutions. And how do I evaluate and find out which is more important? What information would you use among the available one? Which of that you will use? I can do that only after evaluating. Do you agree with it? I can agree. I cannot just like that agree. Whatever has been put forth before me, I have to evaluate and then agree with that. And how would you evaluate as straightforward questions? And finally comes creating. So the learner creates. So here, new ideas. It's not ideas, new ideas. And information using whatever has been previously learned by the learner or the student, whatever it is. So when I say create, when I say new ideas, right? Of course, another discussion which always goes in most of the departments when it comes to finally a project. So we say, you know, it has been already done, right? Why don't you create something new? So then the problem comes, how do I judge whether it's a new or a repetitive one? So when I say new ideas create, probably we'll have an equivalent word, innovate or invent. And if that is the case, then yes, it is like, you know, something, an invention which is patentable, means which no one has ever done that, right? So the keywords are, have you designed something? Can you design something? Design a new, it could be a structure or a new program or a new algorithm or a new processor or a new machine, whatever it is. Again, construct something newly, right? new plan or a proposal. Right? Say, for example, now the entire world is facing a pandemic. Of course, it's new for us. Probably elsewhere, probably in the 20th century, it was. Probably most of us have not seen such a pandemic, worldwide pandemic. And how do you plan for that? How do you create a plan for that? How do you create a solution for that? Right? And produce something new, probably a new product, new solution, new material. And this is what I said, it directly goes with creating new ideas, invent, devise something, solve a complex problem for which no one has ever found a solution. Right? So now the questions, can you design or design a mechanism or design a circuit, design algorithm, right? Or what possible solution can you give for this perennial problem, right? Can you create a proposal which would solve this pandemic or a water scarcity, whatever it is, right? Now, in the beginning, I told you, we are supposed to define a course outcome, and this course outcome should be related to RBT level. And when you want to always achieve a higher RBT levels, how do you define your course outcomes? And defining a course outcome again in turn depends upon your syllabus content, right? Your syllabus content is something different, and you cannot create a course outcome which represents a higher level of RBT. So this is a sample example taken from this is a mechanical. Because I should thank Dr. Ramesh Babu, because it was prepared, this slide, this content was given by him. This is about a course called Manufacturing Technology. So the course outcome one is, at the end of the course, the students will be able to remember the classification, construction, and working of general purpose and special purpose metal cutting machine tools. So classification, yes, they'll remember. This construction, I told you. Of course, we normally ask a question, draw the diagram of a lathe and name its parts or label its parts. So definitely it comes under remembering, and it rests at RBT level 1. And of course, one more thing, when it comes to defining the course outcomes, strictly for the entire course, there is no fixed number like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Depending upon the syllabus content, I can have just 3 or even just 2 course outcomes. But normally, initially, we defined 3 to 4. And later on, you know, the governing university, the governing body said, you know, have one course outcome for each of the units. And we have 5 units. And we are forced to create 5 outcomes. So in this process, what happens, most of the courses, the first unit will be introduction. And obviously there you cannot create analyzing or playing all those things. So it will be only at that remembering level. So that is L1. And next is, at the end of the course, the students will be able to understand the concepts of mechanics of metal cutting, how the machine removes metal. So now understand, it's at level 2. And the third is, upon completion of the course, students will be able to develop a manual part program for a given part diagram. It's for a CNC machine, a computer numerically controlled machine. So now I am developing something. So it's at level 3. And here, CO4 is, students will be able to select a particular machine for machining a given component from various machine tools. So they analyze and then evaluate, right? And then they'll be able to select a particular machine. So which is at level 4. So now the COs and RBT levels are linked, and RBT levels are, so these two have to be mapped. So now for the earlier one, for this particular course, this is the mapping. L1, L2, L3, L4. But what does NBA say? NBA says start from 3, right? Minimum level should be 3. Only then it is of use. So this is what is existing for this particular course. As I told you, this is because My syllabus content is only like that. I couldn't take it beyond that. So what is preferred is a minimum level of 3, and it has to go up to 6. But again, we have to be practical. Of course, I, without much of understanding, of course, I when I randomly, when I go rounds during a CAT exam, I see question papers randomly pick and then see these RBT levels have been wrongly denoted there. A question which belongs to only 3 has been put as 4 or 5. So practically, so just because NBA said it should be 3 and above, and to satisfy that, we cannot just like that put 5, 6 there in the questions. So practically possible, in most of the courses, it will be very difficult for you to come to 5 and 6. Right? Some courses may go up to here, but most of them will be from 3 and 4. So at least we should ensure that when you are framing your syllabus, the course outcome should meet RBT level of 3. So probably there are 4 outcomes here. Maybe these 2 stands at 3 and this at 4 and this at 5. So that is how we have to work our syllabus content. Right? So this is probably, I have used the word prefer. Maybe it's ideal. In ideal condition, yes, it's something like this is needed. But preferably, at least at this, and 1 or 2 if possible here. To that extent, we must ensure that we have prepared the syllabus content. So again, you know, to understand Bloom's taxonomy, as I told you, it's again, you know, based on some judgment for which you should have gone through a lot of examples and case studies. So probably I'll quickly go through 2, 3 examples. I'll not take much time. So look at this. So remember, so these are all related to one particular concept. So it will be easy for you to understand. So for a Bloom's level of remember, how do I define my learning objective or outcome? So by the end of this lesson, course, the student, I mean, here it says lesson because they, based on the sessions, a student will be able to recite means what, reproduce Newton's 3 laws of motion. So this is a very common question. Write Newton's 3 laws of motion. Maybe we want to slightly trick the students. We don't say 3 laws, we'll say write Newton's laws of motions. Someone might write 2, someone might write 3. Probably that is the smallest trick or twist we give in a question. Right? Recite Newton's 3 laws of motion. And understand, by the end of this lesson, the students will be able to describe Newton's 3 laws of motion in his or her own words. You recollect the earlier slide where I told, explain in your own words. So this they can do only when they can understand. And third, having understood, by the end of this lesson, the student will be able to calculate or solve the kinetic energy of a projectile. Right? Given a projectile, applying the Newton's laws, how do I calculate the kinetic energy? Next level. So having, he's able to do this now, apply and he's able to calculate. Next is, by the end of this lesson, the student will be able to differentiate, because he has calculated the difference between a potential energy and a kinetic energy. This is possible only when he knows how to calculate that. And then next is evaluate. By the end of this session, student will be able to determine. So I said, you know, when there are more than one, how do I evaluate them and determine or decide? So whether using conservation of energy or conservation of momentum would be appropriate. Again, you know, more appropriate. That's the key word here. More appropriate for solving a dynamics problem. So he has to determine. So first he needs to know what are the laws, what actually they are, understanding it. And using that, he calculates, he differentiates between potential and kinetic energy. And based on that knowledge, he decides between conservation of energy or conservation of momentum. And finally, by the end of this lesson, the student will be able to design an original homework problem dealing with the principle of conservation of energy. So here, he is designing a problem and solving it. So this is one example how the Bloom's level and your core subjective are matching, right? So we are supposed to start from here, but understand, without these two, you cannot jump here. Means an introduction is given here, make them understand. But when it comes to assessing them, when it comes to evaluating them, you start from here and definitely not here. So this is again another sample question, something related to electronics. I'm sorry, as I told you again, you know, it goes from top to bottom. So remember level, draw a logic symbol of AND gate. Yes, you will draw that. And next is write truth table for given combination of AND gates. And apply those truth tables and solve problems. And realize or analyze a multiplexer by selecting optimum gates. And compare and contrast. This is the keyword we used, we discussed there. So when I say evaluate, we are only comparing. Compare and contrast two methods for implementing given function. And finally, if the student comes through all these stages, then he is at this level where he can design a counter state machine. Right? So yet another example related to mathematics. So again, starting from here, remember, define a linear equation. Yes, you'll memorize and then write it. Explain why y equal to mx plus b is called a linear equation. So only when he understands what a linear equation is, he'll be able to explain why this is called as a linear equation. So calculate the slope and the y-intercept of the straight line shown in the graph. Of course, analyze. You can give him a problem and ask him to analyze. So again, when I say evaluate, this keyword comes to decide which method. So there are the three methods given here: elimination, substitution, and graphical. Among this, again, you know, solving. Now the keyword is which is easier among these to solve simultaneous linear equations. So you will say maybe you can give a guess, say that the substitution method is easier to solve, but he is supposed to justify. When he is to justify, yes, he has to understand this. So given any two linear equations, devise a rule. So he is supposed to devise a rule or create a rule. Now, fine. I don't know, at least in my case, most of the courses which I handle are theory-based. Right? So there is a general notion when it is a theory-based paper, how do I ask questions at higher RBT levels? Right. Of course, going by the conventional way of setting up question papers, now you look into past question papers and all says advantages, disadvantages, list, define, all those things. But is there a different way where I can at least slightly raise my RBT level? Right? So let's say again, and I'll give a few examples. So this is one question, of course, related to automobile, and of course, this is related to Formula One racing. They have different types of tires. So they go to the pit stop depending upon the track conditions. They keep changing the tires. So if you ask a question, right, you say, what are the different types of tires, or list different types of tires used, they write it down here. But instead of asking this question, I say, select the tire type to use in wet conditions, right? Then, yes, he must select one among them. Again, you know, let's assume that he studied somewhere, he say, soft tires are used in wet conditions, right? Then still, again, it's at level one because he remembers he has studied somewhere. But justify your selection. Then, yes, the level goes up because he needs to say, soft tires or the treads in wet conditions, you know, the proper grip between the car and the track is better. So something like that, he's supposed to give explanation for that. He's supposed to give justification. So the same question, by slightly tweaking it, I change the way I ask the question, the level has been increased. See, necessarily need not jump from L1 to L4 or L5. At least it can go from L1 to L2 at least, or from L1 to L3. That's another question. List different types of networking technologies. Say LAN, WAN, Bluetooth, Bluetooth. Of course, when I say networking, Bluetooth also is used to connect more than one device wirelessly, and Wi-Fi or internet. So this will write it. Instead, I take the question and say, select the appropriate technology which will aid IoT, Internet of Things. Of course, there is a keyword here, Internet of Things, so you'll straight away select this. But again, when I stop here, it becomes level one. When I say justify your selection, yes, he has to say, because you know LAN is wired, WAN is also wired, Bluetooth, there is a limitation in the distance communication. So because of that, Wi-Fi or internet can travel long distances, so I am choosing this option. So I just, the same stuff, but I tweaked my question slightly and I raised the level. So this is related to electronics, list different types of microprocessors. Right, of course, I don't know the expansion of this because I'm mechanical. So these are different types of course, this I know, it's digital signal processing. So they listed the microprocessors. But if you ask the question, select the right processor for ALUs and multipliers, right? Then, of course, he has to, so it's superscalar is the answer for that question. But he has to justify why better suited for arithmetic logic units and multipliers. So without understanding the functioning of all the microprocessors, he cannot answer this. Now I have raised this level. So next is, you know, another question. This is related to civil. List different grades of cement, right? That's a L1. OPC, PPC, PSC, super grade, right? Because each are used in different applications. Probably this one most of us would have seen in TV, super grade cement, right? A lot of advertisement comes. So instead of asking a question like this, I say select the right grade for dams and bridges, right? Then probably again he'll answer PPC grade is more suitable for dams and bridges, but you have to add this word, justify your selection, because they have different properties. And why that particular grade is suitable for dams and bridges. So he needs to understand what is the requirement for dams and bridges, right? They withstand only static loads or the dynamic loads. And to withstand that, how this grade of cement helps them, right? So I have taken this and I have raised this level. So like this, of course, one thing is for sure, you as a teacher has to spend a lot of time in preparing a question paper, right? Of course, first time, of course, once you understand, then it will be easy for you to tweak your questions to raise your levels, right? And consciously, you ensure that every question addresses at level 3 and above. So maybe, I don't know, the heads of the departments are there. In some cases where I am not able to raise it to 3 and above. See, for problematic subjects, it's always easy to start at level 3 and go 3, 4 or up to 5 also. But in theory-based subjects, it's very difficult. So ensure that most of it are 3 and here and there it is at level 2. That is the first level of solution for today's problem in SVC, in the present situation. But it's the right time you understood this, because we are going in for regulation 2022. Now we are in regulation 2018. In 2022, we have to ensure that we cannot cite the reason as it is a theory paper. We definitely has to raise the content level of the theory papers also, wherein the RBT levels can be set at 3. Of course, as I told you, this is an urgent requirement. Today I focused on Bloom's taxonomy. And definitely there will be a session wherein I will tell you how to write a course outcome. Again, only when you know how to write a course outcome correctly, you will be able to judge the quality of the syllabus content, right? So this is all about Bloom's taxonomy. And again, I repeat, this it's very difficult to give you a clear cut intersection, like you know what you do when you want to design something. There are a set of rules based on which you apply the rules and straight away get a solution. Whereas this Bloom's taxonomy, it goes a lot into judgment, right? And again, you know, over a period of time, you need to practice. Thereby, your judgment becomes better, right? Initially, you know, you assume, right? Then judge. Then out of experience, you know, your judgment is validated. So that is how you have to become an expert in this. And definitely, you cannot become an expert in one day, overnight. Of course, I myself, you know, I've taken so much pain, you know, getting these questions here and, you know, trying to find out how to tweak, right, and applying that, right. So please keep in mind the quality of education is very crucial, especially in the present day. And one more biggest problem what we are facing is due to the pandemic, there are no regular classes, there are no regular stream of exams, right? So how the industries are going to deal with our students, right? How they are going to assess or judge the quality of our students. So that is very important. So that's all from my end for this. So just have a quick review of what we discussed in this session. We listed out what are the OBE terminologies and what Bloom's taxonomy is, who created that and why it was brought into picture, and what are the various definitions of Bloom's taxonomy, and how this RBT and the course outcomes are related. And when you are mapping it, it's very essential, even before you finalize on a syllabus content, at every stage you have to keep mapping it so that you'll be able to correct the syllabus, right, to put it at an appropriate RBT level. And for each of those Bloom's taxonomy, what are the keywords for those definitions? And we saw various example questions to understand how these different levels are applied. And finally, I was able to give you few examples, you know, wherein the existing questions can be tweaked slightly to raise the RBT level. So that's all from my end. If you've got any questions, you can post this in the chat box. Um